Extraordinary men and women went before us with unmatched resilience, enduring hardship when called upon to defend and liberate. They said yes. They found courage to rise with every sun, loyalty toward their country, discipline for every command. Even in the darkest hours, they said yes. They cherished and fought for freedom, so those coming behind them were assured of it. And when the moment came for them to give it all, their futures never to be written, they said yes. Today, we think upon their sacrifice and find our way to honor them. Saying yes to making the most of what they gave us and filling the earth with God's goodness. We thank them for their yes. They will never be forgotten.
Yeah, give it up. Thank you, thank you. Welcome to the well. We're so glad you're here. We're going to begin the morning, as always, just with worship to God. So I invite you to stand as we begin to sing.
Stop, 'cause you are
Waymaker, Miracle Worker.
keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Sing that one more time. Amen. That is what we believe. So let's welcome up Kevin for some announcements.
Good morning. Welcome to the well. My name is Kevin. And man, first unofficial day of summer, right? Official camping weekend of ever. So I'm glad that you're here and not camping, because we'd miss you. I'd be sad. So, but I'm happy that you're here, and I'm happy that I'm here. And if you're a guest, we just say, we hope that you feel welcome. We hope that you feel that this is a place that you can see God working, and a place that what we say is we open the word and just read it, do our best to live it out, and not twist it and make it weird and make it over confusing. It's already hard enough to understand so much in the Bible. And so just needs to be a place, honestly, of healing, a place of comfort, a place of growth. And I hope that that's what you feel this morning, man. We are blessed to be here, to be honest with you. And if you are a guest or visitor or newer to the well, we have these beautiful, wonderful connection cards that we use for all kinds of stuff. If you would like to get the emails that we send out, we don't send a ton every now and then. And then sometimes we'll do a text, but very, very rarely. So if you would like that, put your information. If not, just put your name and fake information. Tell us that you're glad to be here. Or, yeah, I mean, we're not going to check. No one like, oh, my goodness, that email doesn't match that name. No one's ever going to know. So, but at least let us know you're here. Maybe you have questions. Maybe you have complaints. Maybe you... whatever. You could sign up. There's some cool stuff on the back. Next, in a couple weeks, on Saturday, it's June 11th, we have God Hears Her for the Ladies to Ladies Ministry. Great connections being made, friends being made. Yeah, I know the ladies like want to shout and sing. You can. Go ahead. Yeah, yeah. This is what I love about community, right? It's supposed to be a safe place where you can come and work through sometimes our garbage, but sometimes our celebrations, with people who have been through stuff. Every single story's completely different, but we can relate in different ways. And that's a great time, ladies, for that. Men, you'll be hearing about what's coming up for us. Men hanging out soon, but there's some cool stuff in the bulletin you could check out. Sign-ups for Vacation Bible School for our children is still going on. If you have little guys in your neighborhood, friends, family that you would like to have come to Vacation Bible School, you can meet with Jessica or whoever is running the booth in the courtyard. You can also go to our website and sign up. Those spots are going very fast, so just make sure that if you have someone you want to go, make sure that they're there. And then last but not least, for you parents of junior high and high school students, if we have incoming sixth graders in two Wednesdays, so on the 8th, we're welcoming in our new sixth graders. It's always an exciting week. And then the following week after that, the 15th, June 15th, is called In Honor of You. So if you are a grandparent, guardian, anyone who has a junior high or high school student in our ministry, we're inviting you to come. You should have gotten a personal invitation from your student, but I know how it goes. That sometimes they don't make it home. So we gave them 2 weeks to do that. And if you haven't, you'll be getting a personal invitation from me or from one of their leaders this week. It's just going to be a great night, great food, kind of a black tie affair, just us honoring you in a way that we've never done here before. So I'm super excited about treating you guys to a great meal and just some stuff that you get to see your students doing here. So let me pray for us. And thanks for being a part of the well. And it's an amazing place, and God is just doing so much here. God, I thank you for the way that you move in us, the way that you allow us to be a part of your plan, and you have purpose for every one of us in this room. And you've called us, Lord, you've called us in different ways to serve our communities, to care for our neighbors, to love our families. And God, I pray that today is a day of connection, a day of being reminded that we're blessed, that you love us so much. There's nothing we could do to make you love us less. And God, sometimes that's a hard reminder. But we live in a world, Lord, that it's a mess, and there's confusing times and hard questions. And the only way that I believe we can truly find comfort and peace is in you. and you offer that to us. And I pray for anyone who doesn't know that this morning, God, that you connect with them in a way that would show exactly who you are and how you love. Pray for the music that we're going to sing, the message we get to hear, an amazing celebration today with baptisms. And God, it's a great day, and I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's continue on in our time of worship. I invite you to stand if you can and sing out with us.
We worship the King of the mountaintops. We worship the King of the ocean floor. The depths of your grace has saved me from the grave, and yet there's more. There's so much more. We will sing of the love that flows forever. We will sing of the grace that holds us dear. No, we won't be alone, for the love of Christ is shown. Your Spirit's here. Your Spirit's here. So let us sing, let us shout. The whole world hears when praise abounds. We are your voice, we are your feet. Oh God, use me. My life is yours, oh God, my Savior. Death has died today, I know for sure. Oh, and on that third day, the new world was made where death's no more. Where death's no more. So let us sing, let us shout. The whole world hears when praise abounds. We are your voice, we are your feet. Oh God, use me. Let us sing, let us shout. The whole world hears when praise abounds. We are your voice, we are your feet. Oh God, use me.
Sing this out. Death has died.
Death has died today. Now there's nothing left to fear. God has come to save. Oh, we want to draw you near. When we sing your praise, we feel your Spirit here. Yeah.
Sing that again.
Death has died today. Now there's nothing left to fear. God has come to save. Oh, we want to draw you near. When we sing your praise, we feel your Spirit here. So let us sing, let us sing, let us shout. The whole world hears when praise abounds. We are your voice, we are your feet. Oh God, use me. Oh, let us sing, let us shout. The whole world hears when praise abounds. We are your voice, we are your feet. Oh God, use me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Sing holy. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Sing Jesus the name. Jesus the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes. And I will not be shaken. again.
Hallelujah. God, we just want to thank you for the power that we know is held in your name. God, you're the first and the last, the Alpha, the Omega. God, it brings us so much joy just to sing of the power that we know is held in your name. And when we praise you and when we declare your power, God, we can feel it changing our lives. We feel it moving in us. And so for that, we thank you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. You can be seated. Hey, this girl just graduated this last couple days, right? Thursday. All right. Congratulations, Julia. Thank you for serving our church, and we're so proud of you. And, of course, Caleb did the other weekend. We already talked about him, so, yeah, whatever. We're certainly appreciative of them. In light of what's happened in Texas this last week, we felt like that it would be appropriate if we took some time just to not only pray for those who are, gosh almighty, suffering this weekend, but we also wanted you to understand the security that we have in place here at the church. And I'm sorry that we even have to talk about this, but we need to. And so Ed Abrams is over our security team here at the church. And John, I didn't even talk to you about this. We're on the red mic. Are we good? And so if you see Ed walking around with a big headset, that's because we have one of the most well-trained security teams that I know of in churches. We have people contacting us from much larger churches saying, how can we be more secure? And Ed is the guy that's training them. And so I want you to know that we're very secure as we could possibly be here at the church. Ed, I haven't even talked to you about this. Ed comes from a policing background. He helped train SWAT in LA. Worked in Nevada as well, but he has we have some of the best trained individuals that I know of when it comes to church security. And so what we wanted to do, we felt like that would be appropriate today if we just took a minute or two and talked about, in the event that something would happen, what should we do? How should we respond? How should you feel? Are you okay with that? Yes. Okay, so Ed, I'm gonna give it over to you, brother. Do you need this?
Thank you. Everybody can hear me?
Yeah.
That's quite an introduction, I appreciate that. But it's the men and women that work with me that make the team. They are dedicated, and I can assure you that they work hard to do the security for this church. They take it seriously. I've been in charge of SWAT teams. I've been in charge of police officers. I've been in charge of military units. But I've never had a more dedicated group of people than the people that are in this church. So they're the ones that, sorry.
I guess I need to train you on how to hold a microphone.
Yeah, exactly. They're the ones that are the reason that's so successful. We wanted to take some time today to these poor people that have these churches and schools and no security, and we have it here. So we have procedures set in place, we trained, and we thought it was time to let you know what we're gonna expect out of you if something happens. I wanna talk about being calm. These situations are extremely bad for everyone, but the calmer you can be, the better it will be. And just trust the fact that we're doing everything we can to take care of the situation. So some of the things I want to cover basically is if we have to evacuate the church, we're going to have different stages of evacuation. So if we ask you to evacuate at the front of the church, we have an exit on each side here. That would mean that you would come forward and go out these exits. Do it as quickly as possible and as calmly as possible. The second would be, if we evacuate to the rear of the church, Everyone comes in the main doors, but you might not be aware there's also a door that goes to the kitchen that leads to the outside, so there's an extra door back there to go out. And then sometimes you may be asked to shelter in place, and I'm sure you've heard of these things before about sheltering in place. You just stay where you are, stay calm, and we're dealing with some kind of a situation. Church personnel, security personnel will tell you what to do. They will remind you of being calm and try to help you. If you have trouble moving and can't move real fast, someone will assist you. Someone will come and help you. So we just want you to realize that we have that in place, and if you're asked to do it as calmly as possible and realize that we're on the job. Thank you very much.
Ed and I thought it would be very appropriate, though, if we took some time this morning just to pray for the folks in Texas and Buffalo. It's heartbreaking. Our world desperately needs what I'm going to talk about today. Would you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, our heart breaks for those who are grieving today because of the loss of little kids and teachers. Whether it's in Buffalo or in Texas or what we hear on a daily basis, our world desperately needs you. We pray that the peace that surpasses all understanding would guard the hearts and minds of those who are bereaved today. And it's sad that we have to talk about this in church, but it's a reality of the world that we live in. And I pray that you protect not only the well, but those around the world, whether in schools or in churches, that you would give us your protection and that you would change hearts and minds and lives, and that you would give us the ability to speak into those hearts and minds and lives. And we pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Thank you, Ed. We appreciate you and our security team. Oh, gosh, how do you make a transition now, right? But one day, there was a group of animals and insects that got together and decided to play football. And they wanted to play the big animals and the big insects against the little animals and the little insects. And in the first half of the game, the big animals scored all the points. Every time they got the ball, they scored a touchdown. Second half of the game started, and the elephant ran the ball up the middle, and wham! He was knocked over. Tackled for a 5-yard loss. The animals, the smaller ones and the insects, smaller ones were happy. "Who made that tackle?" said the ant. "I did," said the centipede. Next play, the lion ran the ball up the middle, tackled again. Bam! Another 5-yard loss. The flea asked, "Who made that tackle?" The centipede said, "I did." The same thing happened the next play. The gorilla tried to run the ball around the outside, but the centipede tackled him for a 10-yard loss. Back in the huddle, the toad said to the centipede, "You're awesome. Where were you in the first half?" And the centipede said, "Well, I was putting on my shoes." Centipede, you get it. Today, we're going to talk about the importance of having the right shoes to wear when it comes to fighting Satan and how he wants to take us out. We're in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18. We've been talking about in this series, dressed up, about how we have to have the right armor on, the armor of God. And the Apostle Paul was writing this from prison, probably when he was chained to a prison guard, looking at this Roman centurion guard who is armored with all these different things. And he begins, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, to say, here are the things that you need to be armored with because you're in a spiritual battle. Ephesians 6, 10 through 18. He says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God. Again, I just want to repeat it. It seems like we were just here yesterday, but I want to repeat it again. He says, put on the full armor repeatedly in this passage of Scripture. You can't be partially armored and expect to experience victory. Put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. That's what we'll talk about today. In addition to all of this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. So I've shown you over the last few weeks this different image here that gives you an indication of all the different parts of the armor. In week one, remember, we talked about, just in an introduction, that we're in a spiritual battle. You may think that your battle is against someone that you don't like or doesn't like you. You may think that your battle is against the problems that you have in life, but we're in a spiritual battle, friends. Paul says that we have to be fully dressed to address this spiritual battle. Remember, we talked about in week one that we're responsible for putting on our armor, but if you look back in that passage of Scripture, we're responsible for putting on the armor, but we find our strength not in the armor, but in the Lord. He's under the armor. We talked in the next week about the belt of truth. You see that, if we go back to the image, the belt of truth, it held all the armor in place. That's the first place that we have to buckle up. We talked about how it held the rest of the armor in place, that if we don't have truth, then the rest of the armor just falls off. We talked about how truth allows us for swift movement. Remember the term that was used there? If you've been here during these weeks, what was the term that was used in the original text? Gird your loins. And so they would fold up their outer clothing and tuck it into their belt so that they could move. So we talked about being committed to God's truth. Last week we talked about the breastplate of righteousness and how that breastplate of righteousness was the heart protector. We talked about what righteousness is the relentless pursuit of godliness and goodness in our lives. Are you with me, church, this morning? The relentless pursuit of joy and love and goodness and patience and kindness and faithfulness and self-control. It's a relentless pursuit. That's what guards our heart. And today we're going to talk about shoes. Now, for the Roman soldier, the shoes for their armor was not just an accessory. It was absolutely a necessity. So let me show you a rudimentary picture of kind of what the Roman soldier's shoes would have looked like, maybe a little bit sharper on the spikes there. Their shoes would have had spikes. What do they remind you of? What are you seeing right now? Cleats is what we would call them. And you notice that for the Romans, most people wore like flip-flops. It's hard to go in battle with flip-flops. Have any of you ever tried that? Have any of you tried to run in flip-flops? It doesn't work very well. You may blow out your flip-flop. And so what they did is they made sure that they were strapped up around the ankles with these cleats on the bottom. Now, the significance of the shoes were very important because proper footwear was necessary for standing firm without slipping in battle. And that's not hard for us to understand, right? Good shoes enabled a soldier to stand strong in hand-to-hand combat. When the enemy was pressing down on the soldier would not have to be concerned about losing his footing. And therefore, he would have the upper hand to fight. It's been said that one of the reasons that Alexander the Great was able to conquer so many nations was because that he had equipped his soldiers with the best footwear known at the time. I remember my glory days. I played some football in my life. And when I was in high school and in college, we had these shoes where they would have, Caleb, I don't know if you had these or not, but we had shoes where you could unscrew the cleats on the bottom. Did you ever have those? Did any of you ever have those? Oh, we're old. So what we would do is we could unscrew them and change the length of the cleat that you would put in. So shorter or longer, depending upon the turf that you were playing on and the situation of the weather in that day. Today, players at the professional level, I'm told, and I've seen, they carry many different pairs of shoes, depending upon the climate, the turf, the situation that's happening, to keep them from slipping. Women, you know that the right pair of shoes can make an outfit. Can I have an amen? There's a lot of women in here this morning, right? And women, you also know that you could have a good-looking pair of shoes, but if they don't fit right, I'm seeing some head shaking. Come on. You'd rather just take them and throw them away, right? I've told you before that when I was pastoring a church down in Clovis, we contacted what at that time and may still be today the poorest, most needy school district in Fresno County and asked, how can we help your schools? And the teachers overwhelmingly came back and said, our children don't have shoes. They share shoes with their siblings. We have children who show up that are in second grade and they're wearing a size 12 shoe with newspaper stuffed in them. If you in any way could help us put shoes on these kids, that would be amazing. And so I think I've told you before, we helped fit 700 kids with shoes. We had 1,400 pair donated, and so we sent some to Africa as well. And the teachers in Africa, the teachers at West Fresno told us the same thing. They said, those shoes boosted the confidence of our kids. What boosts your confidence? Paul says to make sure that your feet are readied with the gospel of peace. Lace them up, he would say. When the heat is on and when the battle of everyday life comes, the Apostle Paul would say that the shoes of the gospel of peace will enable you and me to stand firm. Peace will enable us to stand firm during the battles of life, and we all have them. How many of you would witness here this morning and say, I've got some battles going on in my life, or I have had? And if you haven't, it's not a matter of if, it's just a matter of when. One time Jesus was talking about to his disciples when he was going to be persecuted. He told his disciples one time, he said, I'm going to leave you. And I'm going to endure some suffering. I'm going to be crucified. And everything that you've learned from me for the last 3 years, I'm entrusting to you to carry on. And guys, I'm going to tell you, it's not going to be easy. Now, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit to help you, encourage you, empower you, but you too are going to be persecuted. So I'm going to tell you guys how you can stand firm in the midst of those difficult times. John 14, 27. I'm leaving you with a gift. Peace of mind, peace of heart. And the peace I give is a gift the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid. And when I read that, I want to say, what? You're leaving us with this message that you've been talking about? How about giving us some extraordinary power? And Jesus says, no. I'm going to give you something that the world can't give. I'm giving you peace. So Jesus said, commit your life to following me, and I'll see that you have peace. You're not going to be removed from the troubles of the world, but you're going to have peace if you follow me. In the heat of the battle, when the pressure is on, you'll be able to stand firm because you have peace. Peace. Many of you are here today and you're facing some financial pressures. Do you have peace? You know how I know you're facing financial pressures? Because every time you go to the gas pump, you need to go to your bank and take out a loan. Some of you are here today and you're facing some relational difficulty. You're having difficulty with a spouse, a child, a friend, a coworker. Do you know that in the midst of those relational difficulties, you can have peace? Some of you are here today and you're facing health issues. Maybe just in the last few weeks you've gotten some bad prognoses and you are just concerned. You know that in the midst of health issues, you can have peace. Some of you may be like me here today and you're just plain tired. Anybody here tired today? Maybe for you it seems like nothing is going right. You're wondering, how long can I endure? Remember, you are in a spiritual battle. Remember this verse in 1 Peter 5:8 that we read a few weeks ago? Stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. When your peace is at stake, the devil is trying to take you out. Get dressed for battle, the Bible says. Put on your belt of truth. Put on your breastplate of righteousness. and get those shoes laced up. My high school football coach would often say, right before we would go out and take the field, he would say, strap them up and lace them up, boys. We're going to battle. Lace them up, folks. You're in battle. Now I want you to hear this, and this is going to be hard for us to hear. God never promised to remove us from the battle. He only promises to give us the peace of heart and mind in the midst of the battle. Woo! You should quote that, Twitter it, put it online. God never promised to remove us from the battle. He only promises to give us peace in the midst of the battle. So what is peace? Let me share with you a story. Horatio Spafford was a successful lawyer and businessman in Chicago. He had a great family. He and his wife, Anna, had 5 children. Tragedy hit their home. Their young son died of pneumonia in 1871. And then later that year, much of their business was burned in the Great Fire of Chicago. He was able to rebuild his business and keep going, though. But on November the 21st of 1873, he sent his wife and his other 4 children across the ocean to visit family in Europe with 313 passengers aboard an ocean liner, only to have that ocean liner collide with another ship. And Miss Spafford survived, but her 4 children died. And when she got to safety, she sent a message and said, "Saved alone, what shall I do?" There was a pastor on board of that ship, and he later recalled Anna, his wife, saying, "God gave me 4 daughters. Now they've been taken from me. Someday I will understand why." Horatio booked passage on the next available ship to join his grieving wife. And as the ship that he was on crossed over where the previous ship had collided with the other ship, the captain told him, "This is where everybody perished." And he stood there. And as he looked over the railing of the ship, he wrote this: "When peace, like a river, attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul." For those of you who may not have been around church world for a long time, that's a famous hymn of the Christian faith. It is well. Often, when I would get a bee sting or not be feeling well, my mom, you know what she would do? Is she would gather me in her arms and she would sing to me. And she would comfort me through her song. And the pain was still there, but the peace came in hearing her voice. What is peace? Peace is a calm assurance in the midst or during life's battles. It's not the absence of battles. It's a calm assurance in the middle of them. Peace is knowing that even though that we don't know what was happening in the future, we know who holds the future. Peace is the quiet confidence that God is at work for my good and His glory, even in the midst of all the junk that's going on in my life. Are you with me, church, this morning? Yeah. Now, here's the irony and the difficulty of understanding this. In order to understand the peace of God, guess what we have to have? Problems, difficulty, storms. How many of you have ever said, I need some peace in my life? Guess what you need in order to experience peace? You've got to have storms. So let's pray that we all get storms. So how do we equip ourselves with the shoes of the gospel of peace? Gospel, that word there means, in the Greek language, euangelou, which means good news. How do we fit ourselves with this good news of peace? Really, one way, rely on God's promises. Do you realize that there's over 3,000 promises of God in Scripture? 3,000 promises of God. And one of the reasons that we lack peace is that we don't know how to rely on the promises of God. Now, I have found in my study and over the years that there's basically two promises that are repeated throughout the pages of Scripture that can give us peace. And this is not an exhaustive list, but there's two promises that I've found that can result in peace in our lives. The first promise is this: God promises to provide for us. During our struggles and battles of life, we can stand firm and have inner peace because God promises that He will provide if we trust Him. Just one of the verses among many is Philippians 4:19. Again, the Apostle Paul wrote this, and he says, "My God will meet all your needs according to the riches of His glory in Christ Jesus." That's a promise. Meet all your needs, not your greeds, but your needs. And Paul, who was writing this letter that we're reading today from Ephesus, from jail, knew this all too well. At one time, when he was writing to the church at Corinth, he described that he had a thorn in his flesh, and nobody knows exactly what that was. Somebody said, well, it could have been a woman. Just saying. Some people said it could have been the fact that he was suffering from friends. Mostly say that probably because what was going on was he was suffering with bad eyesight due to malaria. But it was a thorn in his flesh. He says in 2 Corinthians 12:8 through 10, "Three times I begged for the Lord to take it away, and each time He said to me, 'My grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. So now I'm glad to boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may work through me. That is why I pleasure in my weaknesses and in insults and hardships and persecutions and in the troubles that I suffer for Christ. For when I am weak," what, church? "Then I am strong." So God promises to provide. He also promises to guide. We see this repeated throughout the pages of Scripture. And that's one of the roles of the Holy Spirit, is to guide us. We have the gift, if we are believers, of the Holy Spirit in our lives, and promises to guide us. I couldn't imagine following somebody who had been in leadership for 40 years and had done a good job. But that's what Joshua had to do in the Old Testament. He followed this guy by the name of Mo. Do you guys know him? Moses. So after 40 years of leading the nation of Israel, Moses was passing off the torch of leadership to Joshua. I could not even imagine that. Moses had done some pretty good stuff. Would you agree? And Moses stood in front of the people of Israel, and I want you to hear what he said in Deuteronomy 31, verses 6 through 8. He says, "Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be afraid or terrified because of them, for the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you." Then Moses summoned Joshua, and he said to him in the presence of all of Israel, "Be strong and courageous, for you must not go with this people into the land that the Lord swore to their ancestors to give them, and you must divide it among them as their inheritance." The Lord Himself goes before you, Joshua, and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Amen. Oh, but then Joshua started leading the people of Israel into the promised land. And three times in four verses in the book of Joshua, God had to remind him, "Be strong and courageous. I'm not going to leave you." My favorite verse in the entire Bible, Joshua 1:9, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." God promised a guide. Joshua felt uneasy. The battle was tough. The people were stubborn. You just read the Old Testament. They were stubborn. Have you ever met any stubborn people, friends? Their criticism was hot. You know what Joshua needed? He didn't need more battle knowledge. He didn't need more armament. You know what Joshua needed? He needed peace. And God reminded him of His promises to provide and guide. Now, promises usually have conditions attached to them. So God invites us into a relationship. So God says, "I'll do my part, but there's a part that you have to do." Romans 8:6 says, "Letting your sinful nature control your mind leads to death, but letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace." Psalm 119:165 says, "Those who love your instructions have great peace and do not stumble." Trust and obedience. It's what we see a lot in Scripture. Some of you are here today, and if I'm honest with you, you're not fully armed for battle because you're barefoot. Can I say it again? You're not fully armed for battle because you're slipping, you're barefoot. You're letting the world around you control your peace. You're letting the people around you control your peace. You're like Lucy in the Peanuts cartoon who says to Charlie Brown, "I hate everything. I hate everybody. I hate the whole world." And Charlie says to her, "Well, Lucy, I thought you had inner peace." And Lucy replies, "Well, I do have inner peace, but I still have outer obnoxiousness." Some of us here are allowing the outer obnoxiousness to control our peace in our life. The Apostle Paul says, "Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace." I don't know if you've been like me and you've been through some recovery programs. I have. If you've been through a 12-step program or you've been through some other programs, often they will pray the Serenity Prayer. And typically with the Serenity Prayer, it's only the first like four sentences or first four lines of it that they quote. It goes something like this: "God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference." Reinhold Niebuhr wrote that prayer, but do you realize that the real power in that prayer comes from the rest of the prayer, not those first four lines? So let me show it to you. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. But here comes the power in this prayer. If we go to the next slide, please. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as the pathway to peace. Amen. And then it goes on to say this. Taking, as Jesus did, this sinful world as it is, not as I would have it, trusting that you, God, will make all things right if I surrender to your will. Amen. And then there's more. So that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Amen. Amen. May that be your prayer today. Strap them on. You're in a battle. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, thank you for this time that we've had in your word. And I pray that the peace that surpasses all understanding would guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. We pray this in his name, and all of us say together, Amen. Amen. Thank you for being here today. We're going to have one song, then we're going to do baptism. You don't want to miss that. There's a basket in the back that you can drop your connection cards in, and any offering you may have brought, you can also give online. I am so thrilled that you're here today, and I'm going to go get changed. I love you guys. Thanks for being here today. Can you hear me now? Sweet. All right. As you said, we're going to do one more song, so I invite you to stand as we continue to sing. This is, I believe this is the first time our church has done the song. It's been around for a while. It's called King of My Heart, so let's sing it.
Gonna let me down. You're never gonna.
we have this amazing moment to celebrate some baptisms. So there's Tim. I'll let him take it away.
Hey, everybody. So baptism is very significant for us. And let me just give you a brief explanation as to why. If I take this wedding ring off, am I still married?
Yes.
Okay. But this wedding ring is very significant because it's an outward and visible symbol of the pledge that I made to my wife. When people go through baptism, they're saying outwardly and visibly to you that they're making a pledge to Jesus Christ. So baptism is a lot like a wedding ring. Well, why do we do it like we do it? Why do we dunk people under? That's a good question. I'm glad you asked. Well, first of all, Jesus visibly demonstrated it. We read in Matthew chapter 3 that Jesus went to John in the Jordan and he was baptized, and we want to follow his example. Not that Jesus needed to repent, but he was saying, I am publicly identifying with this man's message. So Jesus demonstrated it. Secondly, Jesus commanded it in Matthew chapter 28. He says, go and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then thirdly, we often remember Jesus for his birth, but he never commands us to remember his birth. He only commands us to remember his death, burial, and resurrection. And a baptism is a symbol of his death, burial, and resurrection. So when these folks come into the water and we take them down backwards, unless you get cremated, that's the way that you're buried. And by the way, that you just so that you know, in most cemeteries, you're buried where if you were to raise up, your head would be pointing towards the east. Did you all know this? Because that's where Jesus says he's going to come from. Did you learn something you didn't know? Okay. And so when you take them down under the water, that symbolizes their death and burial to that old life before Christ. And then when we raise them up, that symbolizes a new life in Christ. It's awesome, isn't it? It's an awesome symbol. By the way, the word baptize in the original Greek language, baptizo, means to dip under. So when you read about John the Baptist, it doesn't mean he was a part of the denomination. They didn't exist then. He was John the Dipper. So that's what it means. And that's why we do it here. We want to follow Jesus' example, the way that he did it, and how he commanded. And so this morning we have two individuals that I have grown to know and love dearly. First is Rulin Strong. I call her Rue. And so Rue, could you come and join me? Everybody say hey to Rue.
Hey. Hey.
Okay, there's another level. All right.
This is a plant lady. If you have any questions about any plants, she's the one to ask. Rue, I'm so proud of you. She's been a part of our growth groups. So are you saying in front of all these people here that you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you want to live in obedience to Him?
I do.
Okay. Then based upon your profession of faith in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Say hey to Lynn.
Thank you.
Lynn, I am so glad that you're part of our Well family. You nervous?
Yes.
Well, this is what I get to look at every Sunday morning. So I'm so proud of you. And glad that you're part of our family. Lynn, are you saying in front of all of our church family here that you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior and you want to live for Him?
Yes, yes, okay. I do.
Okay. And based upon your profession of faith in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, And in obedience to what he teaches, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let's pray together. God, we're so grateful for these folks who have said, I want to live for you and I'm going to demonstrate it publicly, and we love you and thank you for this day that we've had to experience. Bless us as we go from here. We do remember those who have sacrificed greatly so that we could have the freedom that we have today on this Memorial Day weekend, and we just want to say we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a great day.
On your mind today, it always goes to those who don't deserve. It's the opposite of how you feel when the pain they caused is just too real. Takes everything you have to say the word forgiveness. Forgiveness. Anger's own worst enemy. Even when the jury and the judge say you got a right to hold.